Hi, I'm James from McPappy Racing. In this episode, I'm going to show you our new chassis dyno version 2.0. It comes in three different sizes, two-wheel drive and four-wheel drive, chassis testing or motor-to-motor testing without the need to reconfigure. It comes with four different load levels, and if you want, there are even options to simulate an entire race. With Windows 8 or later, it can even be controlled with your voice. We have three different sizes to choose from, the 9-inch, the 13-inch, and an 18-inch. And that can pretty much accommodate anything from a slot car all the way up to some of the 1/5 scales. Those dimensions are in reference to the track width, so just measure the track width of your vehicle and you'll know which size you want. And yes, no matter which size you want, you'll be able to choose between the two-wheel drive platform or the four-wheel drive rollers. The Dyno Frame is a T-slot extruded aluminum called 8020, which allows for a lot of adjustability. On this one, we upgraded the screws here to thumb screws, so you can easily adjust the wheelbase without the need for tools. The T-slot allows you to add parts easily, like an LCD screen, a toggle clamp, wire tie-downs. In the corners, we machined quad anchor bolts for a rock-solid connection. If you're interested in a drag racing dyno, just give us a call and we'll change the length of these two rails on the side here. It's an open air design, and the massive amount of aluminum draws heat away from the resistors and the slave motor. This is important to keep the temperature the same so that you get the proper repeatable dyno results every time. If you're interested in knowing more about 8020, give them a call or go to their website. They'll give you this catalog for free. I love it. I use it for many projects, including my CNC enclosure. At the heart of the dyno, we have a solid aluminum roller. It's a one-piece design, machined on a lathe so it spins perfectly true. On the ends, we put 2-inch bearings, each load rated for over 2,000 pounds. Yes, I know that's overkill, but the design allowed us to do many things. We can bolt the spur gears directly to the ends of it. The entire width is usable, so you don't have to make adjustments based on the track width of your vehicles. And the roller itself is a flywheel. This 9-inch version alone is over 4 pounds. This helps to give us excellent data on the initial motor pull and also to help smooth out the RPM readings. Bicycle tubing makes for excellent grip, and if necessary, over the years is easily replaceable. The left side is where your dedicated slave motor goes. I'd recommend a 21.5, but a 17.5 will also work. We mirrored the right side, which allows you to add a secondary slave for extra heavy resistance, or better yet, if you want to do motor only testing without your car or truck, you can do that as well. Our first chassis dyno allowed for motor-to-motor testing, but required reconfiguring the assembly. Version 2.0 is much easier, as you can simply bolt your test motor on the right side. I've got this slash on our 13-inch dyno thanks to Dwayne, the owner of 702 RC Raceway here in Vegas. Since the 13 and 18-inch dyno handle vehicles of varying heights, I found the best way to hold them in place is a pair of budget articulating arms. Now, I'm a bit of a perfectionist, and I really would have wanted to use our McPappy stainless steel arms that are found on our helping hands, shameless plug, but I also wanted to keep the price down. And these budget arms will work for the job if you're willing to crank down on the knob an extra turn or two. If you want to upgrade to stainless steel, just let me know. On the ends of the arms, I thought about using crab clamps, but these mini spring clamps are quicker and surprisingly strong. The dyno comes fully assembled and pre-soldered for 4 load levels. All of these switches off for load level 1, then 2, 3, and 4. Later, I'll show you how to simulate an entire race controlled by your voice. So why are flywheels and multiple load levels important? The definition of a dynamometer is a device for measuring mechanical power, especially one that measures the output or driving torque of a rotating machine, Another definition is a device for measuring force, torque, or power. And you'll notice both definitions reference the word power. What is power? In regards to electric motors, horsepower equals torque times RPM divided by 5252. You'll notice a common theme here. You cannot determine power based on RPM speed alone. It's the combination of RPM speed and torque that determines true power. Without load, you can make most motors look better. For example, I could apply some voltage to this motor here to free spin it. And then I could replace the rotor with a smaller diameter rotor and the RPMs just went up. Did I just make this motor more powerful? Likewise, I could replace it with a lower Gauss rating rotor and usually the RPMs will go up again. I can mechanically turn up the timing on this and increase the RPMs by 25%. Did I just make this motor 25% more powerful? No, it needs to be tested with a load to find out if the power actually changed. So how about KV ratings? These KV ratings are typically associated with sensorless motors. KV means RPMs per volt, but what you'll rarely hear or read about is this is at no load level. Are KV ratings useful in determining how much power a motor has? No, not really. It was meant to be a basic guideline within the same manufacturer line to compare the motors. You cannot use it if the motor or speed controller has timing settings, or if the manufacturer offers different rotor choices, and certainly cannot compare one motor manufacturer against another. On the same note, I recently saw a guy selling a large four-roller platform for large-scale off-road trucks and buggies. It had no load and all four rollers were free spinning, yet he advertised it as a dyno. This is not a dyno. You might as well pick the truck up in the air and free spin it at full throttle. It's nearly the same thing. So what about one load level? Is that good enough? Well, it's certainly better than free spin, but you can make a motor perform very well at one load level, but fail at other load levels. On our dyno version 1.0, it shipped with just one load level. But on every phone call and email and text, I encouraged the customer to go to Radio Shack, get some switches, and add some additional load levels like I did here in mine. I encouraged them to add at least three or more, but most people didn't take the time to do it. One load level is convenient, especially trackside, to help your teammates get into the ballpark quickly. But if you want the complete picture, the motor really needs to be tested at its full range of resistance that it would encounter on the track. That's why in our version 2.0 dyno, we have four load levels built in, controlled manually or by the computer, plus the heavy flywheel acts as a variable load. So what about one pull versus simulating an entire race on the dyno? Well, simulating the entire race will reveal more accurate information. I'll give you a perfect example of that. Last year in the 2015/16 season, the R1 Works V9 was simply the motor to have in the oval world, which was a conundrum because on paper it looked the same as other motors. The resistance numbers, the inductance numbers, they all looked the same. One pull on a dyno would also reveal similar results. But the R1 tended to finish strong after 2 minutes, where the other motors tended to overheat. So that's one of the reasons why you would want to run a full simulation on the dyno. Now let's talk about the electronics that go inside the dyno. I would recommend the EagleTree data logger. They have a 100 amp version for $70 or a 150 amp version for $15 more, which I would recommend. Gives you a little extra headroom. It's not necessary, but you can actually run this in your vehicle to get data from the racetrack, which we can then use to fine-tune the resistance of the dyno to match your track exactly. We've done the hard work for you for the RPM sensors here. We've bolted them to the backside of this spur gear and machined a hole to run the wire through. That RPM magnetic sensor is $10. If you are trackside and using the mechanical load levels, you can use the EagleTree LCD screen here for $25, which is nice because you don't have to bring a computer then. This will give you the information that you're looking for. Now you can use the car battery or truck battery that is in your vehicle for doing the dyno testing. But if you want a more consistent readability, more consistent results, I would recommend a power supply. Meanwell makes hospital grade power supplies. I'd highly recommend them. For single cell racing, you would want the HRP600-5. This is the best power supply I've ever found on the market for repeatability, for its consistencies in the electronic numbers. It can put out 120 amp continuous, 162 amps peak, so plenty of power there. If you're running two, oh, by the way, you can fine tune the 5 volts down to exactly 4.22 volts, which will match what we're doing here for the racing. And likewise, they have HRP600-7.5, which can is for two cell racing, and that can be turned up to 8.44 volts. So I'd recommend those. PowerGateLLC.com, I believe, is the best price for those. They run around $117. So that's the basic electronics that are necessary to get the dyno fully functional. But if you want to take it to another level beyond that, for less than $100, we can have the computer control every aspect of the dyno, including the throttle, whether that's gas or electric, the resistance of the dyno, and even the timing of when the resistance levels change. And if you're on Windows 8 or 10, you can even control it with your voice. Begin single pull. You can even simulate an entire race. Begin oval race. We've even found a way to trim the beginning and the end of the test in such a way that it's exactly the same every time. And with the Eagle Tree, this can record up to 50 times a second. So that's a lot of data that we can take all of that and come up with an average for the full 4-minute race or 5-minute race, whatever. For computer-controlled resistance, we have the Dyncovi USB 4 relay board here. I believe the price is only about $22, and it switches the resistors on and off, and also dead shorts between A and B and B and C on the slave motor. It can even control the fan too, and that's very consistent. For the throttle control, we have a Pololu Maestro. It's a 6-channel USB board. I believe the price is around $20 on this, and it can control the throttle, whether it's gas or electric. Instead of using the Dyncovi with the resistors and dead shorting, it's possible, I haven't played with it much yet, but it's possible to use one of these extra channels to control a slave speed controller. As long as that speed controller has reverse rotation options in the settings, we can use it as a variable brake. Now, I've done some testing with it, but I haven't done a lot to determine if one test to the next test will produce consistent results with the speed controller acting as a variable brake. We will see. possibly an eighth scale speed controller might be even more consistent. I don't know. For this one, for my personal dyno, I went with a Denkovi controlling the resistors and dead shorting because I know it's exactly the same every time. And the heavy flywheel smooths out the changes between the different loads, so it's not even noticeable that it's technically switching four different load levels. You can't really see it very well because of that heavy flywheel smooths it all out. So for me, a few years ago, I decided to start building dynos because personally, I was getting tired of putting my car on the track and the handling be good, but I didn't have the right power information. I didn't take very good notes on the run lines, and I just didn't have the rollout information. And I needed a better understanding of power. So today, with there's so many variables with the brushless motors, for example, timing in the speedo, timing in the motor, rotor Gauss strength, rotor diameter size, the shimming of the rotor forward and back, how efficient the ventilation is and how efficient the motor runs, and the cooling aspect. There's a lot of variables there, so I really wanted to build a dyno to help myself and you also get a better picture, a bigger understanding of how to control the power and how to share that information with my teammates. If you have any questions, please, by all means, give me a call. I'd love to talk about this stuff. It's great. Thanks again for watching.